So these horses that you see behind you are going to school in the paddock. And what we do is we put horses through a test run. We do everything as if they're running.
Right.
When horses get to Saratoga, you got kids running and screaming and bouncy bounces and music playing and people, you know, hey, yo, and picnics and all kinds of crap going on that doesn't happen anywhere else. So we school them, because some horses really react violently to all the stuff that's going on over there. There's a whole new level of awareness with a horse over on the other side. So those horses are schooling, and they'll go through all the motions. We'll take them over to the paddock, we'll put a saddle on them, we'll do everything we can do to make that horse nervous, because we want him to get it over with today.
Sure.
Now, chances are that horse from one schooling will be just fine. But if that horse goes over there and blows a gasket today, we'll do it again tomorrow. We may do it again Wednesday, Thursday. We try and do it leading up to the race till we get a comfort level with that horse's reaction to the paddock. Because we only run horses every 5 or 6 weeks, sometimes 4 weeks, sometimes three. And you got, at Saratoga, that pretty much gives you one crack at it. And you want everything. You don't want to lose the race before you even get out to the track. And that happens. You go over to that, you hang out at the paddock at Saratoga, there's virtually every single race has some horse that's refusing to let the saddle on, going crazy, rearing up, sweat pouring off them. That horse, that's taking away all his positive energy for the race, and they're blowing it in advance. So we school horses every day. I tell my help, buy new sneakers, because you're gonna need them over here. We have one horse in particular, Runaway Loot, who's running in the Hopeful Stakes on Monday, on Labor Day. And you'll meet him in a minute, but that race is probably the premier two-year-old race in the whole world, and his Achilles heel is that paddock. He is cool, calm, and collected. Every aspect of his daily routine, except the paddock, he is not real thrilled with. He gets to that paddock and he starts pumping up and his veins start pumping, his nostrils start flaring, and I've probably, in the last 30 days, probably schooled him 15 times.
Really?
We schooled him yesterday with a race. Now he's starting to get better. We're seeing that was just starting to turn the corner with him. And so yesterday we schooled him with a race. We actually brought him over with a race, put the saddle on him, put a rider on him, rode him around, and he was pretty decent. He was a lot better yesterday, Runaway Loot. And so I have him scheduled to school with a race on Thursday, with a race on Saturday. I don't want to do it every day because I don't want to burn his mind. And then Sunday is my buffer if I have to. Now, I've also been known to school horses the day of a race, which is kind of cool. You take the horse over there at 11 o'clock, saddle them up, they blow a gasket, you put a hose on them, you bring them back, and then you take them back over at 2 o'clock. And that will work. Ultimately, that's like your worst case scenario. It works. I've done it with horses, and it's definitely a positive. So we'll get him through it, but he's a good horse to watch. He's a horse that could definitely run a significant part of his race in the paddock before we ever get onto the racetrack. So, do you want me to go through everything? Has everybody heard this all before or no?
Well,
it's been a year.
Yeah, that has.
It's been a year. Come on in the office. These are different pictures. If you like superstars, that's Rachel Alexandra in the middle, Bird Stone on the right, the up-and-coming superstar, American Pharoah here, and this horse is the most interesting horse of them all. This is a horse that is listed as being white, and he's registered white thoroughbred. Since 1864, they've registered over 18 million thoroughbreds, and only 172 are white. I've been training horses 35 years. I've never had one. That horse is in my barn right now. So I could let you see him, because he's kind of an unusual thing. Before that horse came to me this year, I had only heard of one white horse on the racetrack, and it was a horse called Clarence Stewart, and he was running in 1979 at Aqueduct Racetrack. He was trained by a guy named Clarence Stewart. So this is the first white horse I've ever come in contact with. People I don't even know come here and see him. I'll see like a man, a woman, and 14 kids walking down that road, and I'll be like, Diaz, I guarantee you they're looking for the white horse. Yeah. Take him there, let him see him, but don't let him touch him with all those kids. But really, he's actually kind of a real kind soul, and some guy that I let see him took that picture for me, and then he dropped it off the other day, so that's pretty cool.
It is cool.
Yeah, cool picture, and he's a cool horse in person. I'll take you guys down to see him when we get all done. I start my day here, 5 o'clock in the morning, and no matter who you are or what you are, Todd Pletcher or Gary Contessa or Billy Mott, you get 30 stalls at Saratoga. Reason being, there's only 1,597 stalls here, and every trainer in the world wants to be here. So the maximum amount of stalls for anybody is 30. I have 80 horses, I have 50 at Belmont, 30 here. Todd Pletcher has 200, Chad Brown has 200. We're constantly moving horses back and forth, but we'll get into that in a little bit. But I start my day here, 5 o'clock, I get a phone call from my assistant at Belmont. We set up a generic training chart about a week in advance. This book here is, for instance, is how we pick our races. It's the Saratoga Condition Book, August 24th through September 5th. So if we go to September 5th, this book comes out around August 18th, so it gives us about 2 to 3 weeks advance notice on what, so we can point a horse for a certain race, and therefore we can do his training, try to plot his training up to that race. There's a lot of bumps in the road, and we call a lot of audibles at the line of scrimmage, but we plot his training based on where we're pointing for. So September 5th, Runaway Route, who we just talked about, Dream Man, DS Boyd, Chasing Bubbles, and Sunday Gravy. Those are my five horses that I have for September 5th. So out of that group, Chasing Bubbles is at Belmont, all right? So I'll get a phone call this morning, and you know, my assistant at 5 o'clock has a training chart on all 50 horses, and he'll say, well, here's the problems. This one didn't eat last night, this one's a little lethargic, this horse is snotting, this horse is coughing, this horse has a hot foot, this horse has pressure in his ankle. We'll go over the problem horses and then we'll adjust our training schedule for the day. Take me about 15 minutes, we adjust the training schedule, then the assistant from Saratoga walks in, we adjust the training schedule, same thing up here, we have the same problems. Foot, snotting, coughing, sick, whatever. We adjust the training schedule that day, and then at 5:15, riders put the saddles to the horses here, Gulfstream Park, Belmont, Kentucky, wherever my horses are, 5:15. 5:25, horses come out of the stall, 5:27, riders up, 5:30, the track opens, we're the first ones out. First set for me are horses that are mentally challenged, because it's a little darker and a little quieter. By 6 o'clock in the morning, there's 30, 40, 50 horses running this way, that way. That place is like a freeway. At 5:30, I can get my horse that's fragile-minded out to the track. So my most fragile-minded horses go out at 5:30 at Belmont, go out at 5:30 here, go out at 5:30 in Kentucky, go out at 5:30 when we're at Gulfstream, no matter where we are. And it gives them a chance to maybe train a little bit the wrong way. Every trainer has horses that have quirks, and we have to work with them, their mental quirks, and try and make them happy. If I can get them happy on race day, it's all good. But some horses don't want to go to the left. And if a 1,200-pound horse doesn't want to go to the left, you're not getting them to go to the left. Some horses don't want to go to the right. 1,200-pound horse doesn't want to go to the right. That's a little more tricky because we run to the right. We run counterclockwise. So we have to figure out, if a horse doesn't want to go this way, we say, well, what do we have to do to get him to do that? We might have to take him with a pony. We might have to boot him in the behind. We might have to put a little stronger rider on him. Or we might just have to put him in the starting gate to get him to go right. We might have to train him left his whole life, but when we need him to go right, put him in the starting gate with other horses and he follows them out and he does his thing. So we have to work with their little vices and everything they have to do. So once we get our training chart in order, 5:30 we start training horses. We train horses from 5:30 to 10:30. Every horse gets out of the stall for about an hour and a half. They go to the track for about a half hour on the way there, training, walk home, slow walk home. They get walked and they get a bath for about a half hour. They get a bath, they get walked for a half hour. Then they get grass for a half hour. They have a hot walker assigned to them for that hour and a half. Then that guy gets another one and another one and another one and another one until 10:30, 11 o'clock. once they get done, horses can't talk to me. They never talk to me. I don't have any way of communicating with a horse other than the little subtle hints that he's sending me. So when I have to get subtle hints on a horse to know that his ankle's bothering him or his foot's bothering him, because he's not gonna tell me. And horses don't feel pain. They have a very high tolerance for pain. Very big endorphin boost inside the body of a horse. So that's why when horses get hurt bad, they rarely show pain. They'll just keep running, you know? So I look at each horse. That road over there is the equalizer for me. We take horses out on that road, we jog them up and down the road, and we jog them back. Horses are always in softness. The track is soft, the walking surface is soft, the shed row is dirt, but that road is cement. And we jog up and down that road, and we can see the little bit where a horse might be off. So I will prescribe a therapy for that horse. We have a full-time physical therapist. We have a full-time masseuse. We have an acupuncturist. We have a chiropractor. We also have machines. We have a shockwave therapy that takes shockwaves and brings it to the muscles. We have electronic blankets that heat up the muscles, deep heating blankets. We have magnetic pulse therapy that we use on sore muscles. We have the standard stuff, whirlpools, ice, heat, hot water and Epsom salts for sore feet, everything. I will prescribe the therapy that I think a horse needs. Another therapy that we use on horses that's necessary because of the environment in a stable is oxygen therapy. We use oxygen for horses that actually need oxygen. We have a machine that heats distilled water up to 105 degrees and pumps it into the horse's lungs, steam. And when you take that muzzle off that horse at the end of its therapy, there's mucus and all kinds of crap in that thing that's coming out of the horse's head. It's for a horse generally with allergies who gets lots of mucus and needs that therapy. So we have lots of therapy, and the therapy starts as soon as the horse gets back in the stall after his hour and a half. And the therapist will oversee all the therapies. A lot of the simpler therapies are done by the grooms. The more intense therapies are done by her. She'll do it herself. The acupuncture and chiropractic are done by actual doctors. And the massage therapy is done by a certified massage therapist. And she's pretty cool. She'll work on a horse for all day long with lasers and everything else. She's very, very good. Brings a lot of red blood cells to the muscles and does a lot of healing stuff. So once all the therapy, the training, the grass, the bass, the therapy is done, come on outside and we'll take it from there. That's morning. This is Turco Bravo. He won the Birdstone Stakes here about a week and a half ago. He's a 7-year-old. He's made $400,000 already this year. He's a distance specialist. He was the second leading horse in Chile, and I bought him for $200,000 about 3 years ago, brought him to the United States, and it looked like I was the dumbest son of a gun in America. This horse didn't run a lick for his first couple starts for me, and the owners were ready to, they wanted my head on a plate, okay? And all of a sudden, we figured out a few things about him, and it's all about the distance. He runs a mile and a half, mile and three quarters, 2 miles. That's his specialty. The Birdstone Stakes the other day was a mile and three quarters. He won the flat out at Belmont at a mile and three eighths. He won the stymie at Aqueduct at a mile and an eighth. A mile and an eighth for him is a sprint. And he's turned the corner. We figured out that he just wants to be left alone. Riders were sending him, putting him up here, putting him there. American riders think too much. Chile, they kind of let the horse do their thing. And once we figured that out, he's had 3 very productive years. He's an old dude. He definitely would love to bite you. You know, a lot of these horses, they are competitive. You can pet some, they're really nice. Him, yeah, not so much, but he's okay. This is his 7-year-old teeth. I'm going to show you baby teeth compared to that. But he's a cool dude, and he's a success story for us. He's on, that bedding is hypoallergenic. It's the same pellets that you would put into a wood pellet furnace. Yeah. This horse does not have any allergies, but he does have some foot issues. This is Runaway Loot, who's going to run in the hopeful. He's also gone through his thing today. He's a 2-year-old, though. He's run twice. He won his first race by 12 and his second race by 8 1/4. So he's the great brown hope for us. That's his baby teeth. These teeth will all be gone within a year, and by the end of this year, pretty much, like this one's already loose a little bit, they'll begin falling out, and he'll get those longer teeth coming in right behind him.
So they,
he's 2-for-2, he's undefeated. Yeah. I don't know where he stands on the hopeful, because I'm getting a serious lack of respect for him, but I think he's certainly the horse to beat, and he's going to breeze tomorrow, and we should
got
be...
somebody in there?
Oh, Pletch has one, Chad has one, you know, Gary Contessa, Gary Contessa. Yeah. So he is a New York bred, too.
Yeah.
So he might be the best New York bred, but we're taking a little shot here in the hopeful.
Yeah.
And he's a cool dude, and he's even-keeled. He's just like this all the time.
Yeah.
All of these horses would love to hurt me and would love to bite me, but he's even-keeled right up until we take him to that paddock. And that's, like I said, that's his Achilles heel, and everybody has one. Some horses, they'll hear a certain noise and go bonkers. Some horses, just like my dogs, lightning. When the lightning comes, we shut all these doors, shut the back windows and everything. Most of them are cool, don't care. But every horse has a vice. At something they don't like, some sort of vice, and our job is to just try and work them through it. So hopefully you'll be saying after the hopeful, wow, we saw that horse at Gary's Pond, that was really good.
This guy's in today, you got two of them in today.
Yeah, when we run a horse, every horse that I run today is a 2-year-old. And every horse I run today is a first-time starter. None of these horses have ever run. So this guy has no clue what's about to come.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to read him over there. He's going to be like, hey, this is nice. Look at all the other horses. Hey, this is really cool. And then he's going to find out what he's here for.
Yeah.
And you know what? Some of them get it early. Some of them don't.
Yeah.
Some of them will run horrific. Like this horse happens to be the best one that I think. Calculated risker, has trained up a storm, has done everything right, but he might run the worst. You know what I mean? It's how he handles it in here. And I don't know, I can't translate that. Things about horses that I have no control over is how he perceives what's about to happen and how much desire he has. Every football team has somebody that they picked in the first round that didn't amount to shit because they don't have that here. You know, they might be the biggest, strongest, best move and everything, but they just didn't come through here. So I think he's my best shot today, but who knows? This is here because we are on constant surveillance. They want to make sure, you know, let's put it this way. If I had a big syringe in my hand and I'm walking like this over to this stall somewhere, Big Brother is watching, and that's a good thing. It protects the public, it protects everybody. We don't do that. I'm not allowed to give a horse an injection. I'm not allowed to do anything. But they want to make sure my vet isn't in there. No vet. If this horse needs a veterinarian, I have to make a phone call to the state and tell the state that I need a vet and tell them why, and they will send a security team down here to escort that vet into his stall. I can have the blacksmith in here. I can be in here, I can touch his legs, I can do whatever I need to do, but a veterinarian can't come near this horse today. This horse is off limits, and that alerts the public that this horse is in.
How much time, Gary, do you spend with the jockey before you know?
Those knuckleheads, they come out about 10 seconds before it's time to get on the horse. Yeah, do whatever you want. Okay, good, great. I mean, with a first-time start, it's very simple. Stay out of trouble, try and win. I don't know what he's going to do when that gate opens. So do the best you can. I don't have much instructions on that. If I feel I need to give a jockey instructions, I might walk towards the jockey's room and escort him back in because I want to spend time talking to him. But they come out at the last minute. That's their thing. Yeah. This horse has finished his breakfast, finished his training, and he's actually sleeping. Horses put themselves in another place. They will relax a hind leg. You see the hind leg? One of their hind legs will be relaxed like this, and he may or may not be cognizant of us standing here, but that's how horses, they take these cat naps for about 20, 30 minutes at a time. And, you know, if I wake him up because I'm talking to you guys, he might turn around and come out here and then go back and do it again. But the key here is you see that hind leg is relaxed? When that hind leg is relaxed, that horse is in another zone. And it's just almost like a zen thing for horses because they will lie down and sleep, but most of their sleep is standing up. And I'll bet more than likely that truck woke them up,
yeah.
Not me.
Yeah.
You know, because he didn't care that I was talking outside the stall. But when that truck come by, he was like, psh. Like I said, every horse responds to something. This is a filly called Making Havoc. I think you guys understand claiming races. We put horses in claiming races to establish their class level. We claimed her out of her last start for $25,000. She's back in Thursday or Friday for $60,000. I don't know if that race is any good or not, but it's the only opportunity I had to run her in Saratoga. So when I put her in, I looked at it like this. I said, it's the only opportunity to run her back. If I think she has a shot, I'll leave her. If I don't, I'll just scratch her. I'll just scratch her. Huh? Yeah. You guys go to restaurants up here?
Yeah.
This is 15 Church. Our favorite. The owners of 15 Church own her. And she's going to run September 4th. She made one start already, going 5.5 furlongs on the turf. We really liked her a lot. She broke slow, made a huge move, and flattened out. A very positive sign for a first-time starter. She's going to run back at a mile and a 16th. And I think it'll be a different story. I think she's a very, very good filly. She knows we're here because she's moving around now. She's coming up to the front, but she was in that Zen thing. She was sleeping, and she's a very pretty filly.
Yeah.
She's kind. She's pretty. I think she has a big chance to win. And I know one thing: if she wins, I eat really well that night. If she doesn't, I might go out to Galway Pizza because those guys love me no matter what. This horse, is just getting his final cleanup from his groom. He's got his medicine on his front legs. Bandages are not holding the legs on. Bandages are holding medicine in place. So this is medicine that I thought that he needed on his legs. And he's not happy about getting brushed. Look at his ears. But that's okay. He has to. But I'm sure you can imagine what that brush feels like. It's like, get away from me. I'm 1,200 pounds. I'm going to kick your brains in. And they will try and kick you. So that horse is just getting his final touches. This is a nice horse if I can get it to come here. This is Sunday Gravy.
You just scratched her?
Yeah, I did. I did because the evening before her race, she was in yesterday.
Right.
I get a phone call at 8 o'clock at night, and it's a night watchman. And he says, boss, the gray filly, she coughed 5 or 6 times. Well, that's all I need to hear because she's a baby and I'm running against 11 horses who didn't cough 5 or 6 times. She's not coughing for no reason. She's got a little tickle. She's got a little inflammation. She's got some mucus in her guttural pouches. She's got something brewing. So that's enough for me to say, okay, that's it, scratch. And I call the stewards, she's coughing. No problem, you're out. And I will not treat her with anything. I will just let her heal herself, let her body heal her, because she never broke to a temperature. She looks healthy. She just got a little something like our kids. They're coughing a little bit. We don't keep them home from school. There's no temperature. You're going, you know? And it's the same thing with horses. I want to bring it to the front because she's so kind. This is the perfect horse for you guys to pet if you want to take some pictures with her. She is so incredibly sweet. Plus, she's incredibly good looking. She is sweet as can be. She's not loving that camera up there, but she's okay. This is a good horse for you to touch. Her nose is so soft.
Does her eyes seem a little red? Is it? No.
No, she's fine. She trained today. She's like, I haven't heard her cough once. You know, I didn't hear her cough yesterday either, but she was coughing. That's good enough for me. And she's, we would never, unless her nose was on the ground, I'm never going to see her ill. We learn that they're ill by taking their temperature every day rectally, and we are constantly watching their habits. Like if she's a filly who eats slow, okay, I can live with that. But if she's a filly who eats fast every day, and then today she eats slow, she's trying to tell me something. But she's really sweet if you guys want to pat her or anything. She's by Unbridled Song, and she is the spitting image of her father. I mean, this is what Unbridled Song looks like. She's big, she's good looking, she will win. If Gary Contessa does his job, she will win her next start. I have what she wants is to run a mile and a 16th, mile and 70 yards. She wants to run 2 turns. If I can get her in that kind of race, she'll win. And she's really a sweet filly. Come on, girl. and she loves people. She hasn't learned to hate us yet.
Yeah.
Oh. You want a picture with
her? Yeah. Here, put your hand on here and stand right next to her. If she pulls away, let her go, but come up, come back, yeah? But she shouldn't. She might want to nibble on your hat. That kind of looks
okay.
Like... You can be forceful with her. I mean, you can make her keep her head down, you know. And just kind of keep her head where you want it. She'll do it. If she pulls backward, then you let her go. Did you get a picture? Okay. If we wait a little longer, we get pictures of them biting you guys and stuff. But not her. She is as sweet as can be. She loves people. I love her. You can't do that with every horse. Believe me, most horses you cannot do it. But she is a love. She's a complete love. She's the great horse to show people. She's
yes,
the perfect one. You whispering to me?
No, that's the filly that's in the stake.
Ah, this is Mo Promise. She's in a stake race. Do we need to look at these horses outside?
One.
Are you waiting on me to look at horses? Why don't you guys just look at them and I'll watch?
Okay.
Okay? This is Mo Promise. She's in the stake on Thursday. She's by arguably the leading sire in the country right now, Uncle Mo. So she's, I'm looking forward to seeing her run. She runs on, she's also a baby. She runs on baby teeth. She runs on Thursday, and I think she's got a great chance to win. She breezed on the grass today, so she's late, the latest horse we took out. We took her out at about 10:30 this morning. Now, you guys have heard of California chrome?
Yeah.
Well, when we say chrome on a racehorse, we mean a chestnut has a lot of white. So it would be said that this horse has a lot of chrome.
Okay.
And he does. He's got the white legs going, the white feet, the chrome on his face. Not a friendly dude. He looks mean. He is what he looks like with that four top, and he's badass, you know. His name is Adirondack Posse. He's not a horse I would drop my guard on because he would bite me, but he's a very handsome horse. He's got the foretop, he's got the chrome on his body. He's just a very flashy. I ran him, he hooked a track that he didn't like. He got his halter caught on something, he burned the top of his head, a long way from his heart, but he's got that going on up there. He's a good horse, he's a decent horse, but he doesn't like the sloppy track, he doesn't like this, he doesn't like that, he doesn't breathe so good. So he's got his things going on.
He's a diva.
Yeah.
He has a bit of a breathing problem. Good, right? What we do here. Remember I told you how we jog these horses outside? These are the horses that breeze today that I wanted to see. Then you guys got here, so I kind of put these guys on hold, but I want to let the grooms get done. There's the white horse. He breezed today.
Oh,
yeah. So you guys can watch while we jog these horses.
Yeah.
Perfect. Pull the shoe. Pull the shoe, animal intex, hot water and Epsom salts, animal intex, left foot. I know it looks good now, but I want to pull the shoe. This horse here just breezed on the grass this morning, 5/8 of a mile. Whitey. Looks good. I'm pleased with that. I'm looking for the horse. Limp would help. And I'm hoping they don't limp.
Yeah.
And so far, so good on all of these. That's a horse called Old Time Hockey, a 7-year-old. We breezed 5/8 of a mile today. Nice old horse. But I'm looking for a limp, and if I don't get a limp, I'm feeling the knees and ankles, making sure everything's good, no changes. Hold back, Jose. So this horse, you would say, well, geez, he's... You call him white, but he's got all that red in his mane, and he's got those spots on his body, but it's the pigmentation of his skin. He's pink, so he is a white thoroughbred. Okay, thanks,
wow.
Jose. Yeah, believe me, you may never see, I probably would never see another one of these in his lifetime, except for the fact that his baby brother, who's a yearling, is white. So if I don't get fired this year, I'll have another one next year.
Okay.
But you know what, I'm the coach of a... Yeah, but not today. Grass. We entered him today for the grass. Let's wait for the day to race. Okay, we're good there. ¿Quién es ese? Oh, perfect. I didn't see you sneak him out. Foot's good? Okay. Dame 10 por el hoy. 10. And don't say trabajo mañana. I don't want the American people to know what I'm saying. I was Frank Martin's assistant in the days gone by. I was his assistant, and he was right off the boat from Cuba. Good. Enticing, did she hit the ankle? She's got a little cut on the inside of her left ankle. You can see it from here. See that little spot? Inside left ankle. She hit it real bad one time. She breezed today. She did not hit it again, which is great. Okay. She's in on Thursday also, enticing evening. There you go, there's a cough. That horse looks happy. Can I say hot foot? Good. So I'm Frank Martin's assistant in New York, and he's from Cuba, and I'm just out of high school on Long Island, you know? But I know horses. And he hires me. I'm a couple years for Laz Barrera and Jimmy Pacu, and then Frank Martin hires me. He makes me a ridiculous monetary offer to come work for him. And he says to me, and I'm born and raised on Long Island. He says, I don't want these MF American people to know what I say to you, so I will never speak to you in English. And I'm like, oh my God, I got high school Spanish, and this guy's Spanish is like crazy Spanish. He talks 100 miles an hour, and believe me, I was thrown into the fire. Oh, yeah. But I got it. I might have given him a few wrong answers, but he didn't know it. And he was a crazy guy to work for. He was nuts. So all of these horses are all curious as to what's going on. This is a big, beautiful foot. This is another one of those horses where you can do anything with. This is Ginned Up. When does she run, Wednesday or Thursday? Ginned Up, her story is, I'm sitting at the sale with Chip McEwen, and we both love this filly. And Chip is a good drinker, good old boy from down south. He's with the guys from, what's that movie, Uncle Si? What's that show?
TV show
with the guys with the beards.
Oh yeah.
So
yeah.
He's with Duck Dynasty. Yeah. So he's with those guys. So that's where he comes from. Duck Dynasty is with those guys. So we're bidding and bidding and bidding. He goes, hit her again. Give me another gin. Hit her again. Give me another drink. He goes, we get her? I'm like, yeah. He says, how much do we pay for her? I said, $390,000. He goes, oh. He goes, I must be Ginned Up. And I said, her name is Ginned Up. And that's how she got her name. We paid $390,000 for her, and he was hoping for about $150,000. But it was all good. And she's going to be your photo op horse when we get done, and we'll take her out there and take some pictures with her. Another horse in today. This is Outrageous Bet. Again, these horses are all young. It's time to give them a shot. I'm not really, I could find a negative in each one of them. So I wouldn't send you guys to the window on any of them. But they're all ready to graduate high school and go to the college level. And that means loading them in a gate at Saratoga and running them. So that's what we're doing today. I don't know why this is here. In case that horse wants to, in case he's had enough. Huh? Patty Lavelle, I saw down there. Do you want to go talk to her?
Is she here?
Don't do it, DS. Come on in. This is fun.
This
will be the last stop on this tour for today, on this whirlwind tour of the racetrack for you guys. You guys want to stay out?
Yeah.
You been this? Okay. Morning, afternoon. Real simple. Bottom line is, everything that I can do to make a horse kinder and more responsive to the jockey is a better chance of winning. Because a horse that's fighting with a jockey is going to lose a fifth or two of a second, and it might make a difference in the end. So most of it is about control. So talking about bits, today all my horses are babies, and I've had them from day one. So they all wear what I would consider not severe bits. This is an egg butt bit. Horse's mouth goes in here, a lot of protection for the sides of his mouth, very kind on his mouth for a horse that's willing to steer. This is a rubber D bit in the shape of a D. Rubber, very kind to the mouth. This horse might have a lighter mouth than the other horses and very kind for the horses. These are all two-year-olds and I'm fortunate that they're all kind to the riders. That'll help. That'll help for sure. If a horse is not kind to the rider, the first level of defense would be a ring bit. This bit would be for a horse that's a little less kind when it comes to steering. Full cheek sits on the sides of his mouth, helps this. The ring does nothing. The ring sits on their tongue and bounces up and down and gives them something to think about. And it makes them let go of the bit just a little bit and they're a little less aggressive with the ring bit. This would be the next level of bit. Sometimes that's not good enough. I'd say 60% of my horses wear a kind bit, 20, 25% wear a ring bit, which is not unkind. And then the third level of defense here is what we would call a Houghton bit. Horse's mouth is in here, and this bar sits up underneath their chin. Makes them very easy to steer. Jockeys call these power steering. It's for a horse that's just not cooperative. Maybe it's a physical reason that makes them not cooperative. Maybe it's something else. But this will definitely make a horse easy to steer. And blinkers will focus a horse. One of these 3 2-year-olds today is gonna wear a blinker, 3/4. It's gonna take away this, because horses have a 360 degree field of vision. And we're gonna take away this so that horse is focused on what's going on in front of him. And we put a little hole in there so that if somebody's coming from behind, they have that opportunity to maybe dig in. So it's a very standard 3/4 with hole blinker. We use other blinkers to make horses do what we want them to do. This is what we call a cheater blinker. Now we know that horses have that 360 degree field of vision. We take this blinker cup and it's about an inch. It doesn't necessarily focus them forward, but it takes out what's happening behind them. This is for a horse that is too busy watching the jockey. This horse, we call it a cheater blinker because he's running forward, but he's wondering what the jockey's gonna do. The kind of horse that gets this is the kind of horse that is about to get hit and he ducks in, or get hit lefty and he ducks out. So this is a cheater blinker. The other thing we use is an extension blinker. If a horse is very difficult to steer, now this cup could be on this side or on this side. We found if we take away most of the field of vision on one side, for a horse that bears out, this would be for a horse that bears out to his right, just constantly drifts out, it stops him from doing that. Horses don't want to go into the unknown. That's why it takes a real amazing horse to jump over a wall and into a puddle, or you know, in the Grand National, because that's the unknown. Horses don't know how deep that puddle is, and it's trying on their brain. We take away the outside field of vision, they become much easier to steer. So this is an extension blinker, and it could be one on the inside for a horse that lugs in, or on the outside for a horse that lugs out. So that's pretty much it. Yeah. It's all about making horses easier for these 120-pound riders to handle a 1,200-pound horse. They don't cooperate. They don't always cooperate. And if there's a fight, I would not want to go into the ring with a pissed-off horse, because I'm going to lose, no matter how tough I am. So we have to outthink them. And all the equipment that we use, all the little tricks that we use, all the therapies that we use, everything we use is to outthink a horse, or at least get on his level and make him cooperate and address the different issues that he may have.
So how many broken bones have they given you?
A lot. I have a metal knee from getting kicked here, and I had a compound fracture in my knee, ankle, all my fingers, ribs, everything. Everybody on the racetrack, if you watch racetrack people that have been here for 20, 30 years, we all walk like this. And getting out of bed in the morning is even worse. But it's okay. That's what we are. That's what we do. You know, I used to hang out with bull riders. I rode bulls for 4 or 5 years because I thought it was cool when I was a kid. And every bull rider I know does not walk well. That's just part of the business, you know? It's a very physical, very aggressive business. And if you work with horses, you are going to get hurt sooner or later. Because even if a horse doesn't mean to hurt you, simple as 1,200 pounds stepping on your foot, you can have some crushed toes, you know, that's on the low end. So I had a groom last year in Florida working on a horse's leg, and he reached down to get a pin, and the horse snatched his leg up because he had a fly on his leg, and when he put his leg back down, he stepped on the groom's thumb and severed his thumb. And it was that simple. It was up, down, severed thumb, ambulance, boom. So, you know, horse problems happen. Let's get out of here because the flies are bothering you guys.